live.
All right, so officially, woo! Welcome to Arduino Workshop number 5, which is going to be the last one for this semester, because we know finals are here, basically.
And we pretty much already covered everything in the kit, which we realized when making this workshop.
Yep. So.
Oh, hold on, hold on. There, now I'm muted. Okay, now you can't hear me twice. It's like a 30-second delay. Okay,
so the first thing we want to go over is the winter design competition. As we mentioned kind of in passing before, we finally set a date, and the actual competition is going to be on February 4th.
Probably about 7 p.m., yeah.
2 weeks after the week we get back. So classes resume on January 20th. Then the week, and that's a Tuesday. The Wednesday after that, the 28th, there's going to be like a health night. So if you have any final questions or concerns or anything like that, then we're going to set up shop in the BC Info. You can come by and talk to us like you've been doing through this semester. And then the actual competition will be the week afterwards. Room to be announced. Time probably 7 o'clock. But that will be on the 4th.
Yep, and I guess next slide.
Yep. Let's just real quick. So for the prompt, if you guys don't know already, the prompt is to design and build something that will be useful during a zombie apocalypse, and that's an extremely broad prompt. One of our judging categories, as you see, is
Which is a Scottish story, so that it's close by.
Will be applicable, then we'll give it to you. That's a really, really big thing. Like,
big new one.
You say, like, my girlfriend was bitten and she's become a zombie, and the only way that she'll leave me alone is if I give her this electronic flower.
That's off of the
zombie apocalypse. So, yeah, that's really, really broad.
If you turn left out of that, the parking lot in front of the old engineering,
it's
the next left.
It's going to go turn left from and these then it's categories, the next which left. Is originality and creativity. So approaching the problem from a unique angle, solving something that we might not have.
Perfect. Sounds great. Thanks so much.
In a way that you might not originally consider. That's good. Technical execution and implementation. Is it a sound design? Things like that. Functionality and presentation. So even if it doesn't work, bring it and explain why. That's Murphy's Law. And the first rule of demos is that it's going to stop working during the demo. We have experienced this multiple times.
Every time.
every single time that we've done a demo, something different has gone wrong.
Yeah, or so, something interesting happens, like you want to show how your project will rain if it's raining somewhere else, and nowhere else is raining.
Yep, so that's fine. If it doesn't work or doesn't work at 100%, don't worry about it. It's not gonna hurt too much. And then adherence to the prompt, and that's really wrong.
I said, I think with the open design competition too, we've had projects win that weren't fully functional.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and the reason they still scored highly was because even though they didn't work 100%, people were able to explain why they didn't work and explain the troubleshooting steps that they might have gone through to look at it.
Yeah, like maybe your something blew up at the end because you had an accident.
It did work, and then my cat ate the wire.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah, what's important is that you made something, we want to see it.
Yeah.
Prizes! So first place prize, just like last year, I think, was a Raspberry Pi. If you've ever used one of those, it's basically a small little Linux dev board.
It's a full Linux computer.
Yeah, it's 700 megahertz. I don't know which model we're getting it. I'm guessing
it'll be B or the B plus.
B or B plus. So it should have 512 megabytes of RAM. Basically, you install the operating system on an SD card, plug it in, and you're ready to go.
Plug a keyboard, monitor, network up to it. It's really, really useful, and it has GPIO pins, so you can break out into hardware things. So you can do all the stuff that we've been doing with the Raspberry Pi in a Linux environment. And they're extremely useful, and they are one of the accepted boards for the Open Design Competition this spring. So if you win this, you get a free Raspberry Pi that you don't have to count against your budget in the spring, and that's a very powerful tool to use for your projects. The second place prize is a USB host shield for the Arduino, and all that does is it adds USB support, so you can plug
USB devices into your Arduino, or plug the Arduino from the USB host shield into your computer and have it show up as a virtual keyboard or mouse or other USB device, which is really nice because that gives you really easy ways to attach a keyboard to your project or to attach a mouse to your project or to make it show up on the computer easier than just using serial and processing on the computer itself. So that's a really powerful addition to the Arduino. Third is a $15 Spark Fund gift card. So you can use that. And this, all the stuff in here, if you use it towards the final competition in April, that won't be counted as part of your budget. So that's good. And then there's a mystery prize for the most useful project in a zombie apocalypse. So if you do a really good job and make something like, oh man, that would make the difference between life and death, then you will get this. And this also is a survival tool that can be applicable in every single circumstance that I can think of, and it's really cool. I'm probably going to buy one for myself for Christmas as an early Christmas present, so it's definitely something to gun for. Anyways, so before we move on, anybody have any questions about the winter competition? Yes.
What's Mystery Prize?
Mystery Prize! It's awesome. Yeah. It's called, I can tell you this, it's called the Shovel. So, anyways. So the next thing, quick announcement. It's not a shovel, but it's called the Shovel. BattleBots. This is something that we've been working on, the officers have been working on for a little while. We'd like to start a chapter of the IEEE Robotics and Automation Society at CSU, and we thought, what better way to kick that off than by making robots that fight each other? And the details are still being worked out between us and the legal department of CSU to make sure that we get everything squared away safely and stuff like that. But it'll happen over winter break, the week of January 12th, and it's going to be kind of a marathon engineering session. It's going to be a lot of fun. So it's a one-week competition to design, build, and battle robots. So what will happen is on January 12th, all the participants will meet up and be broken up into teams between 2 to 4 teams, depending on how many people participate. Throughout that week, it'll be just a marathon of designing, building, testing, repeat, stuff like that. Your chosen design, and then at the end, we're going to have a big barbecue and have the actual fight. And we're really excited to put this on. We think it's going to be really a lot of fun. And the level of participation in this, if you have like work obligations or anything else over winter break, that's fine. If you can't do this, that's understandable. And if you can only do it like half of the week, then this will just be in contact with your team so that they know what's going on. There will be a small entry fee, about $10 per person is what we're thinking right now, and that will help us try to foot the costs for parts, because these things can get kind of expensive, and the more people that participate, the more intense that we can do this. So I think we can expect, our president is the one that's leading up this, but I think we can expect an email sent out to the entire College of Engineering before finals week with more details as we get them available, and all that stuff will be posted on the IEEE website. The main one, not the design website. So yeah, before we move on to the actual workshop, does anybody have any questions about that? Okay. Well, so the next stuff, the only remaining components in the kit that we haven't gone over in the past few workshops are capacitors, the big three-leaded thing, the N-channel MOSFET, and the 9-volt battery clip. And these are fairly simple. So capacitors, they are electrical storage tanks. They store charge and therefore energy. So they consist of two parallel plates separated by a dielectric, which is essentially, for our purposes, it's an insulator. And I don't know how many of you have taken Physics 2 or EC or electromagnetics or anything like that, but they go over capacitors in detail. For our purposes, they can be used for digital circuits, they're not really as much of a concern. For analog circuits, they're extremely useful in creating timing circuits, oscillators, things like that. But we have a microprocessor to do that for us. So what do we use a capacitor for in a digital world? Well, we use it to debounce switches, and we can use it to stabilize voltages. If I put the put this up here, I can show you on the board if I can find a marker.
So when you have a voltage source in your project, a lot of times it will respond to fluctuations in the power supply, which are caused by interference or things like that. So your 5-volt source, which is supposed to look, just a sec. So your power source, which is supposed to look like that, if this is time, that's the axis of time, and supposed to look like, if it's supposed to look like that, it actually kind of looks like this, where it fluctuates a little ways around the actual value. And with sensitive digital components, that can actually introduce some undesirable behavior. It might detect the switching around these points, especially if all of a sudden you get like a momentary disconnect in the power supply, so it spikes down. That's going to be detected as a change, and even some of these smaller fluctuations will be detected as a change as well. So we use capacitors then to smooth out the voltage, because since capacitors will charge to a certain voltage, and then if that charge is taken away, they will try to maintain that for as long as they can. So if we have a this is a very, very good thing to do, by the way, if you have an external, like a microchip here, like a shift register or something like that. It has a 5-volt pin and a ground pin here. It's always a good idea to connect across those two pins directly from 5 volts to ground to connect a capacitor across those two pins, because then the capacitor is going to stabilize this voltage and remove those fluctuations. So, yeah. The Arduino already has, if you take a look at your Arduino, it already has a couple of capacitors on the board. So if you're using the power supply from the Arduino, from the 5-volt pin, that's not really a big deal. But if you're using an external power source, like the 9-volt battery, it's pretty much always going to be a good idea to have a capacitor in there to stabilize the voltage.
For those watching on Twitch, Asa basically just drew that bottom left picture.
Yep.
Man, nobody knows where this building is. Okay.
Okay. So let's move on.
So yeah, next thing we haven't really gone over is the power FET. It's basically just a different type of transistor. It's an N-channel MOSFET. Instead of having a collector, base, and emitter, it has a source, gate, and drain. The main difference is the gate. As you can see on the circuit diagram here, this is kind of like a capacitor, to where it doesn't actually, they don't actually touch each other.
Right. FET stands for field effect transistor. So whereas in a BJT, in the NPN transistor that we covered in the last workshop, those are switched when current actually flows from the base down to the emitter. But in an N MOSFET, there's a potential voltage created between the gate and the source, and there's actually an electric field generated between, there's a physical separation between a layer of silicon at the gate and the two layers of silicon between the drain and the source. There's a physical insulated separation there, and it creates an electric field that allows electrons to flow through a channel.
Yeah, I didn't get to find a good picture on that.
Yeah.
I can show anyone later if you're curious. It's
and then our yeah. So one of the things we talked about yesterday was controlling motors with, or not yesterday, last workshop was controlling work motors and other high current applications with transistors. The NPN transistor in your kit can switch, I think it was about an amp of current
fuel? I think an amp max. This one, yeah. I think, goes up to 2 amps. 16 amps?
No, sorry, you're right.
What, 2 amps? Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah, so. I have a big one that can handle 16 amps, but this is 2 amps. So it can handle a lot of current going through it.
Yeah, this will handle some pretty strong motors.
Yeah.
Okay, and then we have the 9-volt battery clip, which is basically, you can hook a battery up to your Arduino.
Yeah, and power it without the USB cable. Because
you can
when the Arduino is actually unplugged from the computer, the program is stored in its program memory, which is non-volatile, so it doesn't lose the sketch that you've uploaded to it. So you can plug it into an external power supply and run it just as if it was connected to the computer, except, of course, any serial stuff won't work.
And then, so since this is a 9-volt, this adapts to a 9-volt battery, you wouldn't plug it to the 5-volt, because what you'd do is you'd plug the red wire into the V-in, or voltage input. So when the voltage from there is automatically regulated so that 5-volt output is 5 volts. If you put anything other than 5 volts on it, you could mess some things up.
Right. If put the screen up and turn this off, and I can draw a quick diagram.
Oh, yeah.
So, let's say you had a motor connected to your Arduino that needed to run off of 9 volts. Of course, the Arduino doesn't supply 9 volts, so you need to use the battery clip, you need to use an external power supply to do that. So, you have your Arduino here, and you have your digital out pin that's connected to that. This is where you want to drive your motor from. But you can't drive it directly, so first you have to hook up the external power supply. So you have V in and ground. So you hook this up to your battery here with V in going here and ground going there. And just going to for our purposes, it's just ground. Now the other thing that you need to do is your motor over here, it can't be powered directly by this. It has to be, this pin has to switch the 9-volt power supply. So you would use, in that case, a MOSFET or a BJT to do that. So I'm just going to illustrate it with the MOSFETs and such what we've just looked at. And this is the N channel MOSFET like that. So, and then of course you have your protection diode going like that, and then that connects to ground. So what this is doing is it's using the 9-volt battery to completely power the Arduino and the motor. The battery is connected to the VIN and the ground pins. The VIN pin of the Arduino is going to go through the Arduino's built-in regulator chip on the board and power the microcontroller and the rest of everything with a 5-volt signal. So then when you toggle the out pin, when you toggle this high, when you toggle it to a 1, it's going to send a 5-volt signal across this wire to the MOSFET transistor, which will turn it on. These MOSFET transistors turn on at about 2 volts, so this transistor will turn itself on, allowing current to flow from the 9-volt battery through the motor. So you power your motor with 9 volts, but switch it with a 5-volt signal through the MOSFET. Does that make sense? Don't hesitate to ask questions. That's what we're here for. Yeah?
So what does the MOSFET actually mean? Like, what is being switched?
Oh, here, hold this. I want to draw.
Okay.
So this is kind of like the internal idea of a MOSFET. So basically,
ECE 331 in a nutshell.
You have your kind of capacitor part here. This is the gate. Then this is kind of your whole thing. So in an MFET, you have these. So this is all silicon here, and
this is P-type.
This
silicon.
Is P-type, which means it's positively charged, so it has an abundance of holes.
Or a lack of electrons.
A lack of electrons, yeah. So this is P. And then both of these wells here are N-type. or negatively charged have an abundance of electrons.
Yes.
So basically what you...
Here is
and then you have a...
Source, drain up there, source there, I believe.
Drain...
I mean, I guess it doesn't particularly
you
matter.
You just flip it back and forth. So in the end MOSFET, it flows from your source...
Drain to source. Well,
so when you... Yeah, it flows...
Drain to source.
No?
Yep. It's electrons flow from source to drain, but the conventional current is drained to source.
Oh, the whole Franklin issue.
Yeah, because of Benjamin Franklin. Yeah, conventional current.
Oh,
electrons
right.
go from the source to the drain.
Okay.
But yeah, anyways.
Now I'm confusing myself. Okay. So, let's say... Hold on, let me draw this so I get my bearings here. Okay, so this is the schematic symbol for it. I have no sleep. So you're saying that... No.
Drain, gate, source. Sorry, source, gate. No, I was right the first time. Drain, gate, source.
Okay, it's been a while. Drain, gate, source.
I can check our slide schematic just to make sure. Yeah.
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 Goes.
Wait.
Yeah.
Well, but this one's kind of upside down, isn't
it? No, it's not. That's a diode.
Oh. Oh, okay. Just kidding.
Ah, okay. Ah, there. Yeah. So, when you put a higher voltage here, it allows current to flow this way. And how that basically happens is, so, right now, your drain is hooked to, say, 5 volts. Well, I guess in that picture, it's 9 volts.
Mm-hmm.
9 volts. So then this is hooked to ground, or 0 volts. So then here, when you change this to a 5 volts, you make an electric field here that kind of lets the electrons flow this way, right?
Yeah, other way. The electrons flow the other way, but
electrons
current.
Flow this way, but your current flows this way. So it kind of creates an electric field. You can kind of imagine it going like that.
Yep, that's the channel.
That's the channel.
Mm-hmm.
So, long story short, put this here, then it creates a field here that bridges this gap.
So the electrons can flow.
So when you change, so when you put this back to 0 volts, then this bridge is cut, and then your electric field looks like this.
Right.
So then, yeah, so when you put this higher, then this field kind of gets stretched. Like
and there's a whole thing about channel length modulation where you can actually change the amount of electrons flowing,
change
what's going on
this,
in here.
All that.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, that's,
and that's
annoying, to put it lightly.
It's hard.
Yeah. Transistors and MOSFETs are a very dense area, so don't...
If you're an ECE major, you'll learn it. If not,
yeah.
Don't
if
worry
don't,
about it.
Yeah,
if you don't,
if you feel like a little bit lost right now, we feel a little bit lost in all of our in these classes. It's... It's they're tough. Yeah, we share your pain.
Yeah, you get a doctoral degree to really understand all this.
Yeah.
So okay.
Yeah.
So 331 in a nutshell.
Yeah. So for our purposes, the way that we explained it in this diagram, the 5 volt signal is going there, which opens up a channel between the drain and the source, which allows current to flow through it. And otherwise, it acts as an open circuit. So no current will flow when this is below the threshold voltage.
Right.
Which in this instance, for these MOSFETs, I believe from the data sheet, it's about 2 volts, 2.5 volts.
Yeah, it slightly changes, but yeah, 2 volts.
Mm-hmm.
Don't want to get into that.
Yeah. It's different. It is different for each MOSFET transistor, though. So if you get another one, then it's absolutely prudent to look it up in the data sheet and see what's that. Yes.
You have to worry about how much current is going to go.
How much current flows through it?
Yeah, because
through it and to turn it on.
Well, actually, there's no current that flows from here
There's no current going through here.
Because it's a capacitor, essentially.
It's essentially a capacitor. Because there's actually, if you notice, there's no physical connection between the gate and then between the gate plate and then this whole substrate. There's no physical connection. It just,
there's a dielectric material.
Yeah, the potential, like the potential created between the gate and the source is what opens the channel here. The electric field created by that potential, not the current flowing. And that's the main difference between these FETs, which is literally stands for field effect transistor, which is descriptive of what's going on. That's the main difference between FETs or FETs and BJTs, bipolar junction transistors, which is what we went over last time.
Yeah, which those junctions are touching each other.
Right. Those
here they are not.
Yeah. Those look like N-type, P-type, N-type, and it's actually connected to the P-type silicon in the middle, which is
So
That's FETs in a nutshell.
So here. Okay. Right, okay. Alright, so with that, let's go ahead and get to the project.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this one's kind of fun.
One kind of short project for you guys today.
But this one's kind of—it's one of the projects Austin did with us when we were first in here.
Yeah.
So pass this around, everyone. Just tear out a note card. If you mess it up, we have like 50. So.
Yeah. And this is the point of this is to kind of get you guys to realize you don't have to be limited to the stuff in your kit. You can use a lot of different household objects to make some cool things.
So, like, this is essentially what we're making with the note card. This is kind of a homemade variable resistor.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, when I measured it, this was about 500 ohms between here and here. So what I did is I drew a whole bunch of, and we'll get to this too, so you don't have to write anything down. You scribble really hard with a pencil, and then I just kind of made three dots that are kind of
because
like
pencil lead is graphite, which is actually conductive to a certain degree.
Yeah. And then I put wires in here, which I pulled out.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Yeah.
So.
And then, so basically what we're going to do, we put a voltage across here, and then we have a third wire.
It's all on the slide. We can get to that as we go.
Just explain what it is. So and then you basically, you can measure the voltage at any point on this line. So. First, draw that on your... Does anyone have a pencil? I did... It does work with mechanical. That's what I have.
Really, as thick as is absolutely possible with a pencil, because that makes a better connection.
So... this down here. So I'll go ahead and do this with you so I can make a new one.
Now if you don't mind, I'm gonna put a piece of
go for it. Yeah. Okay. So if you want, you can tear off the top. I'm doing that. So just scribble as hard as you can, and I'll put mine here for reference. So the thickness of the line. It's about, I made mine, I don't know, half a centimeter or a quarter of an inch. It shouldn't matter what side you do it on, but I like the clear side, whatever you want to do. And make sure you kind of get all the way to the edge if you can. It's not crucial to get to the edge, but as far over as you can, since how we're going to fold it over. Connect to the wire.
How separate should those circles be?
Let's see.
Distinct, I guess. So, not like circle, circle, circle.
Yeah, I would say leave about an inch from the edges until, about at least an inch until you hit the edge of the circles, and then kind of space them evenly. So one in the middle, and then two kind of on the sides. Mine, this one here, they're about an inch apart from the centers of each other. But you don't have to make them that big either, really. It's more just to give yourself a note of make sure that when we're doing this thing, you touch it in the same spot, because otherwise you'll get different values for reading in, and this won't work very well. So make sure to make it pretty much as dark as you can, and you don't want any gaps, and like so dark it's shiny. And you guys ever used to do a thing where you scribble really hard and then you wipe your finger and you use fingerprints? Basically like that.
Yes. I might even go harder than that. Or graphite.
So here, I'll pass this around so you guys can kind of see it. So everyone has a pencil, right? Cool. So I have like one extra. Space mine very well. Okay. There's mine. Okay. I kind of fudged mine up here. Good enough. Okay. Is everyone good? Almost? Not quite. Okay. I'm gonna grab a piece of water in the head.
I gotta head out. I have a symphony rehearsal.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, I'd be remiss not to plug it. If you want to get into the holiday spirit, the University Symphony and the chorus is putting together a holiday gala concert, which is a huge production. It's going to be really great. Tomorrow at 7 o'clock or Saturday at 2 o'clock and 7 o'clock. Two tickets are $7 for CSU students, and all of the proceeds from the concert will go to fund scholarships. So it's going to be really awesome, and you should all go. So, have fun.
Bye, guys. All right, you're all mine. Ha ha. Okay. So next step here. We just need to bend some wires. So on this note card, you see the little dotted lines. So those are about a centimeter long. Basically what you're doing, if you see by this card on the back, you just kind of do tears along, tears like that. So you don't tear them off, you just tear horizontally so that they become little tabs. So here I'm going to tear about a centimeter, then another centimeter, so they're about even. And it's just a little tab. And make sure to do it around the black line. So this is going to be used to wrap our wire up to get that properly connected. And then, so yeah, what we do, we're just going to wrap our wire in it. So I found the best way, you guys can't see this, but the wire is kind of hooked like that. Try not to poke yourself with your finger. And then I'll pass the tape around. You might want to wait to fold it until then, but basically you just kind of set it against the paper there, and then you fold it three times. So you fold once, I guess twice, and three or two, however fits, and then you'll just put a slab of tape right over the top of that. Let me pass it around.
And then one thing I like to do is I taped it to the desk also, so that'll help it keep moving when we start poking it. Yeah.
How many times do you water?
You don't need to get super bent. The last thing you want to do is poke a hole in your finger.
I almost did that, but didn't quite.
The wire through the paper and then wrapping it?
No, just flat on top so that the metal contact just kind of lays against it right like that. And you just wrap it up until you get to the end of these lines. And then on this slide here, you see you just kind of tape them down. And then, as you see, like on mine, it has the tape. I did that so I just tape it to the desk so it wouldn't move around. It makes it easier when you're actually playing with it. So, pull this one up. Does that make sense? Yeah, I guess mine only fit two wraps. I thought it was three, but okay. Then when the tape comes around, I'll tape it down. I mean, it's really whatever you want to do, but I found this was the easiest. Because then it basically tapes it to the table right here. And it's easy enough to just take off and is this, as you see this one, it's still a solid chunk. You can move it around if you want to keep it. Oh, and then I guess later on in the workshop we'll see. You probably want one of these green wires, at least one, so feel free to have wires if you need them. Okay, so we've got the tape. Tape mine down. Oh yeah. Tape down. Okay. Okay then. I don't know what that is. Alright. So, we got our thing taped to the table. It's ready to be hooked up. So now we just hook it up to the rest of the circuit. So basically all we're doing is we're just putting a straight 5 volts across our resistor. And then we have kind of our stylus, which is just, like I said, I like the green wire because it's the longest one. And that's going to be our what we use to sense the voltage along the card. And this resistor here, it's basically like with the button, it's just a pull-down resistor. So that whenever you're not, you know, touching the card, it pulls it back down to ground. So you get a zero reading instead of basically ambient temperature. What is going on here?
Hey, lights. Quit it.
Jeez. Okay. So, what I've shown here is bend these in a little and plug them in. One in the ground and one in the 5 volts.
Is the resistor red, black?
Oh yeah. Sorry, it's a 1 mega ohm resistor. It's a brown, black, green. You should only have one of them. So okay. Okay. So, yeah, brown, black, green, gold, 1 mega ohms. So essentially what this is going to do, so along the whole note card, you know, when you touch it in a different spot, it'll have a different voltage because, say, the 5 volts has to dissipate along the entire card. Pretty simple.
You missed the resistor.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't really matter too much which one it is. It's just a higher one, so it doesn't sell as much.
Correct.
So, that's...
Oh, so that's like 10K.
Yeah.
So what's the stylus?
Oh, that's just a wire.
A big green wire.
So basically, it's just kind of hanging off right now. That's what we're going to use to touch the car to act as the sensor.
Oh, the whole thing. Okay. Yeah.
Oh yeah, and then we're sent. You can see we're sensing it in analog zero. So I don't know if you can see this one on the table. It's just right now this wire is just sticking straight up in the air.
Sounds good.
We have one person watching. Yay. I hope it's not just me. Could be, but I don't know. If anyone wants me to double check or take a look. Need more tape, yeah.
I think the school
paid
a lot of money.
Yeah. And Justin felt so bad the time he forgot. So he's been really good about it now. He's like, pizza has been ordered like 5 hours in advance. You're set to go. Cool. And then we have too much. Which is, it's a good problem to have. Yeah, that's not really a thing.
Yeah, I've never heard about that. What? Oh! Did it not have one of those? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, grab more pizza. I can't carry it all home.
I have it so much. Like it needs to stop. Okay. Is everyone set to go? So next thing we need to do, we need to calibrate it for the program we're going to do. So this is the entire program. It's just simple output whatever you read in to the serial monitor. And we're going to use that. So, I'll put it back up right now. You guys see that all right? All right. So, we're going to open up our Arduino. Simple, define our input pin, which is A0, and then do our setup. So we have to set up our input pin, stylus. And it is an input. And then we need to start our serial. So begin at 9600 bits per second. And now we have our loop, which is simply output it to the display every 4 times a second. Serial.print. Oops. Someone called me. Someone is calling me. Mom, not now. Print line. Make sure you do an analog read.
Is this all C
programming? Yeah, it's based on C. It's kind of proprietary. Yeah, I mean it's not C, but it's basically C where you have to use Arduino methods instead of like void main and stuff like that.
That isn't a big difference.
No, it's pretty much the same. I don't really know if there's really many differences to think of. Okay. So, I guess first we need to plug in the Arduino. And then upload it. Make sure we got Arduino Uno, COM3, go! All right, and then once it's done, of course, we want to open the serial monitor. So does everyone have the code all set and written and done? Cool. So now we just need to run the calibration. So to do that, you just open the serial monitor. And see here, mine's just, it's just spitting out zeros. Should be spitting out zeros now. You might get, sometimes if you kind of touch it, it gets some one or two or very small values. That's okay. So if you touch it to any of the three, you should start reading a value. So what's I get? What do I have right now? I can't look at those. Ah, okay. So I'm getting consistently about 440 something on that one. So what we're gonna do below each button, as you can see in the slide, just kind of put a general like 20 count or 20 unit window. So we know if it's within that, we're touching that button. So it's so hard to do this. So for my window, it's going to be between 440 and 460. So write that down somehow. Okay. Then you move to the next one, do that same thing. So here it's probably between 490 and 510. These are really nice numbers.
So what if you're not getting that difference between the circles?
Oh, how big a difference are you getting?
I mean, like, I'm getting like lowest in one is 460, the one lowest in the other one 470.
Oh, so they're like 10 apart. Okay.
Yeah, but if they also overlap, it's...
Ooh. Let me check how far apart the buttons are.
So
there we go. Okay. Left side lines in this one. Try making your buttons bigger because they're about the same thickness. That might help. Try that out. Is it not doing
anything?
Oh. Is this just I using it up.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Oh, okay. Let's see. Is this how
that works?
Yeah. So when that finishes, it should be okay. It should find it. Yeah, we know that you need to think back and sell those drivers. Just the first time it takes a couple minutes. If not, we know that you want to do that.
Something can be bigger and bigger. It's the same margin.
Yeah, so it's see if that works. So yeah, just put a range where they don't overlap and where they're most consistent, I guess.
Okay.
It doesn't, they don't really have to be 20 apart. Just I found that to be a good one when I first tried this. Okay. All right, so now I need my last one. Which is 510, 530.
So this is a 0.5 pounds.
Oh.
Max. I think it's
Oh, yeah.
I haven't had that comp before, so it was just strange.
Yeah, I think it's a lot.
And I don't understand why Mac does those names, but it does weird ones. Okay. One thing I did find is if we wait too long on the calibration, it might change a little. I mean,
let me see if mine did. So this should be a 490, 410. Oh, so now it's 480, 500.
So if we're on the 30s, I think it's
about 30. 30s? Really?
Ooh. That.
29, 32, 33, 32.
I think it's because that's a.
Oh, but it's a short one. What is it? Yeah, it's because I don't know where it's a green. That's a 10K.
Yeah, it's a 10K. Is
yours?
Oh, here I was. I'm just getting it one out.
I guess it does matter.
I think it's the only one with green. Okay.
So for some reason, this is working better even though the circles are about the same size as the lines.
Yeah, I tried like 5 different note cards last night when I was putting this together, and I don't know. It's a little funky. I mean, this is why circuits aren't made of note cards and pencil. But, okay, I guess as far as the range, just make it so they're separated by significant amount. So for mine here, like my first button range is
1, 2, 3.
First button range is about 410 to 430, and it keeps slightly decreasing. So I'm going to say the range, we'll just make it bigger and broader. Say it's 300 to 455. And the next one, say it's 456. 505. Next one, you say. Okay. So now that we've somewhat calibrated these things, and you wrote those numbers down, we are going to get the code to recognize a password on this keypad. So it's kind of long. So go ahead and just get it, grab it from the website, and I'll just kind of explain it here. So I have it here. So all you need to change when you grab it from our site is the password you want the user to enter. Mine is 231. We're in room 231. And then you just have to change the min and max value for each key. So you see, mine last night was kind of higher for some reason, but it changes per note card, I guess. So my values here, I have to go change those. So button one, I said it's 300, anywhere between 300 and 455. Oh, under the workshops tab, there should be workshop 5 code files. Yeah. Let me know if you guys can't get to it, and I'll fix it. And then 455, I think I said. Oh, yeah, and yeah, another thing I did is I labeled each button so I remembered which one it was, and that way you know which one it is in the code. 1, 2, 3. So, and then button 2, we're going to say it's 456 through, I said, 505. And the next one, 506 through 700. So those are the limits that I kind of measured on mine. You really just need to split it up so that it's easy to distinguish where you're touching along the card. So if you measured, you use those measurements you guys got. It's going to take a bit of tweaking. It took me a bit of tweaking. So is everyone find the code okay? So then what this is supposed to do when you upload it, and you open the serial monitor, it asks for the password. So let's try 1, 3, whoops. Okay, so that's one thing. You see it said, I thought I said 100. So the way I wrote the code is if it's not within any of those ranges, it just says 0. Which means that my calibration is off again. Oh, okay. Yeah, way off. Yeah, this is what happened to me the first couple of times. I was touching the 2 pad just now. So we'll swap back to our calibration program. And I guess kind of figure that out. I'll upload that. Oh, already in use, okay. Okay. Open that back up. Alright, let's see. So 1. Oh yeah, so I don't know if your guys is doing the same thing, but my numbers are slowly degrading. And then, oh, that's bad. Okay, so now I have decided to swap between these. Okay, let's try that. Okay. Now let's try button 1, make sure all works. Nope. Still the instrument. This took me a few tries last night as well. Oh, I see why. Okay. Okay, so my one button that works. And two button kind of works. Three button kind of works also. Jeez, it's everywhere. Well, it worked last night. Have you guys gotten yours to work really well at all? Okay. I finally went that to work. So basically, when you put in the right password, it says you win. Or Lee Taxors. So yeah, that's some kind of neat thing you can do with the card and the pencil. As I've come to realize, the voltage levels seem to kind of migrate, like slowly get lower. I don't know if your guys are doing the same thing. Set this guy. Try it again. Oh yeah, see, that one's not even working anymore. All right. Enough playing with it here. Oh, so yeah, run it, check the 6mm. And that's all we have for you. That's Workshop 5. So, yeah, I guess we look forward to seeing your projects for the Winter Design Competition. Hopefully they work better than the note card does.
So do we need help with the design of the circuit?
We will have that help night, and if you just want to email us something, that's fine too.
Okay. I know where I need to go there.
I
know
what I got you. Yeah, I said I will be here almost all break except the first week. So, and we're going to try to check the email regularly and all that. So, if you guys need help with your circuit or anything or advice, send us an email. I think that's the best way to get to us on the CSU IEEE. Otherwise, check out the keep watching the site. And BattleBlots information will be on csuieee.blogspot.com. So not our design one, but just CSU IEEE. I don't know when we're going to have all those details ironed out, but when we do have them, they'll be on that site. So, yeah. Grab pizza. And we will let you know when the next workshops are next semester.